rejoice this morning. Amen. 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 Father, we're moving from the inside of yourself that I just rejoice in the Lord. So even if you are covered, you know, your mask is covering your mouth, just smile in your mask anyway. Brother, yes, you. Yes, just smile there, just rejoice there, and just tell yourself, I am happy in the Lord this morning. I rejoice in the Lord. I rejoice in the power of His might. He is my God, my shield and my buckler, my stronghold and my strong tower from the enemy. I look up to the Lord this morning, the author and the perfecter of my faith. He is my strength. I am strengthened because of the Lord. The joy that is bubbling up in me gives me the strength. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. What else feel? Amen. And this is a beautiful morning. It's nice to see all of you today in the house of the Lord. And we just rejoice in the Lord. Amen. Amen. Last Sunday, we dealt with the spirit of unbelief. I want to believe that during the week, you have still been dealing with that spirit. It's not a one-time thing. Amen. Because it's one time you are believing, another time you are feeling like, you know, ujamini sana. Is that true? So you have to continuously deal with that spirit and cast it out of our lives. Amen. If you are not in service, if you are not in the church, please watch. Amen. Just watch that on YouTube, watch it on Facebook. I mean, and that would be nice. That you are dealing with the spirit of unbelief. And this is really prevalent so much in the church. And that is what we're supposed to ask, not seeing a lot happening in the church. And imagine if all of us come to church full of faith, full of anointing. We have woken up and even prayed, maybe even just 1 hour in the morning. And we are also refreshed in the presence of God. You can imagine what will happen in the church. And our faith is lifted up. Bwana Yesu asifiwe.
Amen.
Yesu is coming to pass.
Amen.
Bwana Yesu asifiwe.
Amen.
It's just you and me who will make it happen. Amen. So today our topic is the heart. Today we are talking about the heart. The heart. The heart. That is the topic this morning. Very closely related to also what you are dealing with last week, the heart. Remember the book of Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23. Proverbs chapter 4 and verse 23. Proverbs 24 and verse 23. I'd like us to read it out aloud together. One, two, let's go. Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life. Can you read it again so that you can take it in? Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring issues of life. Let's have it in NIV. In NIV. NIV says, above all else, guard your heart. Amen. Can you read it? Above all else, Zaidia yote, guard your heart, for it is the wellspring of life. Amen. The heart, if you look on the physical, the heart of a human being is really everything, isn't it? When the heart stops, you know, and that's it. During the conception, the first organ, the very first organ that is normally created in a baby, when a baby is, you know, being created in the womb of the mother, is the heart. So normally when one goes or a mother goes to the clinic, to the hospital, they check their heartbeat, isn't it? Even as a baby grows and such, every time a mother goes to the clinic, the nurse comes and, you know, they put in something and they hear and they say, I can hear the heartbeat. You know, it's a normal heartbeat. There is the heartbeat. So you can see that in the physical, the heart is the most important thing in a human being. The heart. Stop stamping their God, you know. It's the one that really feeds the rest of the body. Is that true? One as it is. It's the one that pumps, you know, the blood, you know, to and out of, and the, you know, again, I mean, it just has a lot of functions that it does. And that way then we keep alive. That's when you go, you know, to the check, you know, the blood, the heart rate, how does it beat, you know, it is this against this. And if they tell you it is normal, they tell you say it's abnormal, we need to do something. So the importance of the heart is valuable. Amen. And that's what the Bible tells us, above everything else, anxiety, anxiety, guard your heart. What do we normally guard? We guard valuable things. When I ask a few, you know, out there as you come in, there's normally just a whole big chunk of trash. Nobody guards that because it's not valuable. One has to feel. But if you go to Central Bank, there are lots of guards all around, you know, military. And that, you know, when money is being transported, I'm sure you have seen money being transported from the airport. Is that true? They push you and they just get you out of the road. One has to feel. And these are armed fellows, you know, seriously. You know, they are just... all of them, they are cocked guns, they are guarding the money. It is valuable. Why? Because it can be stolen. So the Bible tells us, just like we see valuable things guarded and watched over, that we guard what? Our hearts. Guard your heart with all, and the Bible says with all diligence. Guard it, take care of it, preserve it. Check on it. Value it enough to take care of it. Guard it. Why? The Bible says it's a wellspring of life. That's where life springs from. Amen. When you go to a spring or to a river, the source, you know, the source is very important. When the source is cut off, there is no flow. True or false? So the source must be guarded. What is coming out of that source? And what you might even allow to go into that source. That's what the word of God tells us. It is valuable. That's the importance of the heart. It is that important. Even in our own bodies, you see where the heart is placed, isn't it? The heart is protected, you know, by ribs, by walls. They just protect that part. So that the heart is well guarded on the inside. It is well taken care of. Bible says, guard it above everything else. Above everything else, guard your heart. And so, why do we need to guard our hearts? It's because of the importance that there is in that. When you read the Bible, it's talking, you know, there's everywhere, you know, the Bible is talking about, I mean, countless number of times, about the importance of the heart. What springs from the heart? What comes from the heart? In Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 7, the Bible says, so it means actually the heart can become hardened. Hebrews 3, 7, the Bible says, so as the Holy Spirit says, today if you hear his voice, do not do what? Harden your hearts. Do not do what? We should not harden our hearts as you did in the rebellion. So you can see rebellion, some of this is that it causes what? Rebellion causes what? Hardened hearts. The Bible is warning us against that. Let's read together. So, as the Holy Spirit says, today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your hearts as you did in the rebellion. During the time of the testing in the desert. It's talking about the children of Israel in the desert. When they rebelled against God, although they had been promised good things, although God had a good plan for them to do good stuff for them, what happened? The Bible says they rebelled. When they rebelled, because of what? Of the hardening of their hearts. So the word of God warns us against our hearts getting hardened. You know, a heart is so important. That is why sometimes you might say, oh, this one has such a hard heart. You know, their heart is so hard. And another one you can say, oh, they have such a sweet heart. You know, their heart is such a beautiful heart. He has such a nice heart. You know, this is a nice person. How do you know that this person is a nice person? It's because of what they, of course, they speak. Because of the way they act, because of the way they behave. And this springs from what? From their heart. One, I guess, as if you. So today, when you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. Even this morning, I pray that as we hear the word of God, let's not harden our hearts. Hardening our hearts means what? Even when you hear the word of God, you resist it. Your inside, your heart does not agree with it. One, as if you were. Your heart does not flow with it. Your heart does not submit to the word. You hear the word, but your heart is so hardened against the word of God that you hear it, but it doesn't help you. It doesn't benefit you. I pray that it is not so today. Amen. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. But that our hearts will be opened to the Lord, will be submitted to the Lord, will hear the word of God, will act on the word of God. Amen. Bwana asifiwe.
Amen.
If this is what the word of God says, you will just open your heart. Don't harden it this morning. You know, sometimes you can talk about this and then your heart tells you, yeah, my heart is not hardened. That is already hardening of the heart. If that's what your heart is telling you, it's already hardened. You must just deal with it today in the name of Jesus. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Each of us at some point, actually our hearts are hardened. And the hardening of the heart does not necessarily mean because you are walking in sin. You might, the children of Israel, by the way, they were not walking. When the Bible says that their hearts became hardened, they were not walking in sin necessarily. Amen. However, who are better than that? They were children of God. They were eating the manna from God. They were being led by God. They had the cloud by day. They had the fire by night that protected them. Yet, they had not sinned. They had not even met the group of Balak. They had not sinned that time. But their hearts were just hardened. You know, and it's a choice that people make from within. But we can deal with it today in the name of Jesus Christ. The Lord is telling us, let our hearts not be hardened. We agree that, Lord, my heart is not going to be hardened. I refuse the hardening of my heart in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Even the attitude that you have can show how hardened our hearts are. Wow. Also, the Bible tells us that we could easily have hearts of stones. Yummy. There are the stones. You can see the stones there, you can see the stones down. Yet some people's hearts are so hardened, they are like stone. It doesn't matter what you tell them, their heart is hardened. They wouldn't change, they wouldn't budge, they wouldn't give in, they wouldn't give up, they wouldn't surrender. Mashallah, so we will be soon. No? You had a child, you know, you beat them and beat them and they still look at you. Say, my head, you are going to go to the moyo, you know, it's like stone. Are they not feeling the pain? Is that? No? Pharaoh was such kind. Pharaoh was a hardened Pharaoh. His heart was so hardened that even frogs were everywhere. In his food, in his bedroom, no? On the bed, you sleep like this, the frogs are just jumping all over the place. You are eating, they are eating also, you know? They are jumping on your food, everywhere. And then he tells Moses, tell God I have sinned. No? We repent. You know, really this time I have sinned. Then Moses asks him, when should I ask the Lord to remove the frogs? He is so hardened that he says tomorrow. That is how hard he was. Yani kuendelea answers, the fullness, and it appears from us. The way they are ugly. They are so ugly with those big eyes. You know? Unalana sinakuangalia. You know? Ukifungua mdomo kidogo, they jump down, maybe. Most of the times when you are asleep, the mouth can, you know, the morota, so the mouth, you know, the frog. He says tomorrow. Instead of saying no. Now. He told Moses what? Tomorrow. That is how hard he was. The guy is so hardened until his firstborn, who is supposed to be an heir, dies. All the firstborns of the Egyptians, they die. Their animals firstborn, they die. But the guy is still so hardened in his heart. In fact, this guy, fine, he says, fine, you people go. Just go. Leave here. In fact, if I see your face again, I will kill you. So they leave. Once they have left, what does he do? Instead of saying, this thing is Nikubaya, leave these guys alone, he follows them. The same ball of fire, which is a light to them, is causing darkness to them, but he still holds on. They cross through the Red Sea, and he actually gets the audacity, the courage, to follow through. That is a hardened heart, brethren. I'm a Mnaonaje. That is a hard heart. I know sometimes we look at that and we decide, no, I don't think me, my heart really cannot be like Hitler's. No, just killing 6 million souls and not feeling a thing, that has really hardened heart. No, like Pharaoh. But when you look at ourselves, there is definitely some element of hardened hearts. Look, if our hearts were not hardened, do you know miracles will be happening? It will be like unnatural. It will be like a daily occurrence in our lives. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Is that true? Why? Because when we are unwell, our body detects to us. It speaks to us. And our hearts get hardened against God. Why? Because of what we see. Today, in the name of Jesus Christ, and even in the rest of the week, this is our week of prayer and fasting for tomorrow. We need to rise against hardened hearts in our lives in the name of Jesus. Amen. Don't look at so-and-so and say, hey, that one, that guy is hard, heart is hard. Introspect, just look at yourself. Do you know even your attitude could really be a hardened heart? Introspect. Look at yourself. Do I have a hardened heart? To some extent, we all do. I'm telling you the truth. If you are not, we'll all really be walking in a lot of divine health, in power, in signs and wonders in the church. And we'll see the miraculous almost on a daily basis in our midst. Bwana asifiwe. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. Ezekiel 36, verse 26. Let's read. I'll give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I'll remove from you your heart of. And give you a heart of. Flesh. This is the Lord saying, I'll give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. Do we need anybody that needs a heart of flesh this morning? Anybody who needs a heart of flesh? Somebody who needs a heart of flesh? Yes, Lord, I need a heart of flesh. Remove every hardness from me this morning in the name of Jesus Christ. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. That he may remove. David realized that. He had hardened his heart against the things of God. When you see evil so much sometimes, it becomes like a natural thing. when he got hold of Bathsheba, slept with her, and went ahead and planned evil in his heart, and even planned to kill Uriah. And of course, actually did kill him. Now, what does the Bible say after that? He came to God and said, create in me a clean heart. He just said, just like God was speaking to the Israelites in the time of Ezekiel. I say, God, create within me, remove this heart of stone. Remove this heart which is so hard. Replace it with the heart of flesh. The heart that is soft. Flesh is soft, same way. It is soft. A heart that is softened towards God. A heart that is softened towards the things of God. A heart that easily accepts the things of God. Amen. Bona asifiwe. That's what David did. He said, create within me a clean heart. Renew the right spirit within me. That is Psalms 51. Create within me a clean heart. Remove this heart that is hardened. This heart that is sinful. This heart that is rebellious. This heart that turns away from God. This heart that is prone to sin. Remove it from me and replace it. God, replace it with the heart of flesh, with the heart that is softened. With a heart that is a soft ground, that is a good ground for the word of God. That when it is sown in me, it can grow, it can bear forth fruit. Hallelujah. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Amen. Now, how do we guard our hearts? How do we guard our hearts? I'll give three quick points. How do we guard our hearts? How we guard our hearts? And number one, it's what we hear. What we hear. What do you hear? What do you hear? What do you listen to? Unasikizaga nini? What do you hear? No? The kind of conversations that you listen to. Your colleagues at your workplace. You are born again, yes. But when they are conversing, are you participating in those kinds of conversations? When they are talking about Mpango wa Kano, do you laugh it off? Do you laugh it off? Like Psalms chapter 1. Those who stand in the council of the wicked, those who participate in what the wicked are saying and doing, do you participate in those conversations? And sometimes they become so normal, they become so normal that the things of God become abnormal. One else was the fuel. Such that having one wife becomes abnormal. Because Mpango wa Kando is everywhere. And it is talked about so much. Until, as a man, you start feeling a bit abnormal. I've only had one wife. And you are born again. Why? Because what you keep hearing has become so normal, that nobody, if you hear, oh, this one, you know, there's a colleague going with another colleague, kuna mwingine, amepata mwingine huku, there's another one moving there, there's another one has one in Ushago and one in town, and they go to church. It looks normal. Why? Because of what you hear and hear. But as the Bible tells us, we did also last week, Romans chapter 10, verse 17. Faith then comes by hearing and hearing what? The word of God. Faith then comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. We must hear and hear. Hearing once is not enough. What is the feel? Like once you have had this today, that you expect that when you go home in the evening, that tomorrow you read your word, you hear it, and you hear it. Yes. Amen. Amen. When we hear and hear, the word of God becomes more normal, and the things of the world become abnormal. Amen. What you hear is what forms your heart. Is what becomes of you in your heart. What are you doing? We are what we hear as well. Why? because we also start talking the same before long, two of us. If you are around negative people, before long you'll be a very negative person. Why? Because that's what you hear and hear. When you stop them, tomorrow they'll not. When they are around you, they'll not talk about some things, which is good for you. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. And you can wonder, hey, the police are quiet these days because they cannot talk some of the things, which are very normal to them. But you, they should be very abnormal. Our norm should be the supernatural. You don't believe that, do you? I'm saying our norm should be the supernatural. The word of God. What the Lord talks of in his word. This should be our norm. We read it so much until we know nothing else but the word. Amen. The adverts. You know, when I skip the adverts, I'm sure right now your mind might be tissue, see tissue. Tissue me, natural. You know, that is what might be going on because we hear it so much, you don't even have to think about it. Is that true? You know, I was imagining if these adverts were the word of God, if the media houses would agree even to put a scripture, which is repeated so much, so that when you wake up in the morning, in a year, you know, you can just hear it in your mind. When you open the radio, you can just hear it. When you switch on the TV, you can just hear it. That faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. If it can come like, you know, by the stripes of Jesus, we are healed. And it rings in us. And you wake up and you sleep with it. And you wake up and, you know, everybody will just be speaking that, even in the streets, even street boys. They may not have TVs, but it is so much until they know it. Is that true?
Yes.
You know, even when you are young, sometimes some of those adverts, when you are young, sometimes you remember them even now. Is that true or false? No? Colgate, you know? Maziwa ya KCC. You know? Those are things you had, you know, some of us when you are young. Until today, you have not forgotten. There are so many, the adverts. Why? Because we hear and hear. It is repeated so much. You know, like some of these adverts, they start with the adverts before you go to the supermarket and find it. So when you go, you naturally, when you see an ad, it's as if you are so familiar with it, you just pick it. Is that true? And yet it's because of the advert. Because we have been hearing it so much. So you straight away go, as if it's like it's your friend. Or if, you know, you just want it. To Najua Omo, because that is what was there, you know, forever. So everything else which is in powder, we call it what? How did we know it's called Omo? Because it started because of the adverts. It was there from the radio before the television was there or before it was popular. Bwana asifiwe. You can imagine if that is the word of God. That we hear it so much. Such that when you sleep, you can just dream about it. When you wake up, you speak it. Wherever you are going, you are hearing. But we can decide to create an environment around ourselves in the name of Jesus Christ. By what? By even memorizing the word of God. Bwana asifiwe. Hallelujah. Imagine when you are not born again. Those who got born again when you were a bit grown, you know, and you had learned the world music because it played everywhere. When you get born again, you have to unlearn that music. How do you unlearn? By learning the Christian songs. True? So that when this other song wants to play, what do? You see, when Malaika wants to play in your mind, you start saying, there is power. You know, you have butcher that. Yes. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. And these days they are even worse. Because the neighbor unaweza fikia kama ni jehana, ajehana kadogo. You know, boom, boom. Yeah, you feel as if the world is really, you know. So when those things, there are so much in you, you just see what young people, you know. That's what is playing in them. I wish the word of God could play inside them. Oh, I love you, Jesus. How I love you, Jesus. Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised. How excellent is your name, O God. Oh, we worship you. We worship you. You know, that. So we have to just remove those using the word of God. Put in the word of God as much as you possibly can. Put in godly songs as much as you can. What you hear, check out on what you hear. And sometimes in the conversations, even in your workplace, some of them might look very innocent, but they're just directing into a certain thing, to hardening of your heart towards the things of God. Most of the conversation, most of the media agenda is to harden your heart towards the things of God, so that you no longer believe the things of God. So that when you're told one wife, one husband, you know, because this by the way doesn't happen to men alone, it happens to women as well. And you know, the media just makes fun of it. You know, the classic, the what you know, most of these ones. You go to the supermarket and hear the conversation that is going on. You know, and me, you know, let's bust him, let's bust her. And people laugh at it. How did it enter? It was just introduced. People started hearing and hearing, and it became very normal. And you find people, you know, just going for another woman and another one, and a woman also married, having another man out there, and it is normal. And young ladies getting children out of wedlock, and it is stylish. It becomes like it is fashionable. Hey. Is that normal?
No.
Not according to the word of God. It is abnormal. The norm is the word of God. It's chastity. Chastity is thrown out of the way. Why? Because of what people hear. You don't have a boyfriend, are you normal? Is that what young people tell each other? You don't have a girlfriend. Ukosawa, bro. So they make the norm. In fact, the Bible says, then in the last is to change the things of God that were good, that were normal, and they will make they were turned to become abnormal. So that when you are doing the right thing, you are viewed as being abnormal. You must be single-minded on the word of God. Write that one down. You must be single-minded on the word of God. Yeah. Our minds must be not turned this way, single-minded on the word of God. Knowing and taking the word of God as the truth, as the norm, and nothing else. Have no other options, that we take no other options. No other options in our lives except the word. Buenas, if you will. If we keep hearing and belief, if all what we hear is unbelief, then what will be formed in our hearts will be what? What will be formed in our hearts? Unbelief. If all what we hear is unbelief, that is what will be formed in our hearts. And the Bible tells us, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So let not people teach you it was a slip of the tongue. It is what is in the heart. Hallelujah. When there is life in your heart, you will speak life. When there is victory in your heart, you will speak victory. When there is breakthrough in your heart, you will speak breakthrough. When there is joy in your heart, you will speak joy. When there is anointing in your heart, anointing will flow out of your lips. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Hallelujah. When there is power in your heart, you will speak. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Number two, meditating on the word of God. So there's hearing. And this second one is now meditating. What is to meditate? To meditate is to stay on something. Staying on. Meditating. And so they get it in Joshua 1:8. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. Do not let this word. Let's read. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. One has a feeling. Joshua tells us, you'll send the children of if you meditate, if you can only decide to meditate on the word of God. Do you know you can meditate on the word of God even when you are at work? Even when you are busy working. On the inside of you can be meditating upon the word of God. That is what you must take. Take even a scripture. And just even when you're going about your daily business, just meditate on it. Just meditate on it. The joy of the Lord is my strength. The joy of it. So even when, you know, you are at loggerheads with your boss at work, whatever it is, inside of you, you can still afford a smile. And people start to wonder, what's wrong with this lady? What's wrong with this gentleman? He is smiling, and then the way he has been given a lady, a good one. The joy of the Lord is my strength. You know, that is what will be ringing on the inside of you. Instead of meditating on your boss, hallelujah.
Amen.
Instead of meditating on your neighbor who has poured dirty water on your nose. You know, some of us now meditate on that the whole day. That one hardens us towards what? God. Such that we are not softened towards God. We start looking at our neighbor as an enemy, at our boss as a, you know, whatever they are, as a devil. We need instead to meditate on the word of God. Don't meditate on your spouse. Meditate on the word. That is what will give us life. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Hallelujah. Meditating on the word of God. And we are sure of prosperity and success as we meditate on the word of God. Day and night. This word of the Lord shall not depart out of my heart, but you shall meditate on it day and night. Stay on. Isaiah 26 verse 3. You can just write it down. That you, our hearts, him you will keep in perfect peace, him whose mind is steadfast. In another translation, it says, whose mind is stayed. That is, I think, in James. The mind is stayed on God. The mind and the heart have very close relations. So our hearts need to be staying on God, meditating on God, staying on him. I pray that this week, I pray that today you start on that. Just having your heart staying on the word of God. Yani inashika neno la Mungu na inakwamilia hapo. Hallelujah. Staying on the word of God. My children will be head and not tail. And your heart staying on that word. This is what the word of God says. I will stay on it. Hanging on it, I stay on it. Na kuamilia hapo, nakatalia hapo. Moyo wangu nakatalia hapo. The circumstances may be saying something different, but your heart refuses. Your heart stays on the word. This is what the word of God says concerning this situation. I stay on it. The circumstances are telling me my business is finished, is closing down. The word of God tells me when I meditate on his word, I get prosperous and successful. So success is my portion in the midst of the circumstances. I refuse to look with the physical eyes. I see with the spiritual eyes. This is what the word of God tells. I stay on the word. I hang on to the word. I have no job at the moment, but as long as I meditate and stay on the word of God, the Lord will open the way. Silver and gold belongs to him. I'll hold on to that word. Amen. This business has ears, it will hear.
Yes.
Bwana Yesu asifiwe. This job has ears, it will hear. These children have ears, they will hear. In the name of Jesus Christ, I will stay on the word. My heart will stay on the word. As it stays on the word, it gets softened towards the word. Just like when we keep hearing the things of the world, our hearts get softened towards the world. And what happens? They get hardened. They get softened towards the world. And they get hardened towards the word of God. When our hearts instead are softened and stayed on the word of God, we get hardened towards the things of the world. We refuse the things of the world. We decline the things of the world. We say no to the things of the world. And we say yes to the word of God. We say yes, the circumstances, yes, might look this, but Lord, I hold on to your word. This is what the word, as long as the word has not changed, I'll stick on there. I'll hold on to this. I'll cling on to this. I'll confess it. You know, when you hear it, you will speak it. Amen. That is going on again, Christians. They corrupt. They are caught by the police and they give up 500 bob. And they say, you know, instead of now going to the court, that wastes a lot of time, you know. And settle out with the Caesar out here. Before you are taken to the magistrate. What does the word of God tells us? He says, God, Psalms 24, who can ascend the hill of the Lord? Is he who has clean hands? And a what? A pure heart. Clean hands. Psalms 24, clean hands. Our hearts need to be clean. Meaning you're not right. You're not participating. If you read the word of God that says that, if you have been reading Psalms 24, you will not pray. And if you have been meditating upon it,
amen.
Who can ascend the hill of the Lord? Amen. Who can stand in his holy place? Amen. It is only the person who has clean hands. These hands of mine are clean, so I'm not praying. Hallelujah. I'm a child of God, so I will not cry. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. My eyes are pure, so I will not watch pornography. My eyes are pure, so I will not watch an ungodly movie. My eyes are pure, so I will not just watch a program for the sake of watching a program. Which is talking about, you know, which is really approving and laughing at iniquity. And laughing at immorality. And people laugh at it, cheating on one another. And people laugh at it. So it becomes normal. Because they meditate on it until they start thinking about it. Until it conceives in their hearts. And before long, it does what? It produces fruit. And you start saying, what happened to this plan? He was a serious plan. What happened to this young lady? What happened to this sister? What happened? I thought they were living holy lives. One has a feeling. Meditating. You know, Abraham was tempted. Is that true? Was he tempted or tested? He was not tempted, he was tested. And also, the Bible tells us about Abraham in the book of Hebrews. He says, although he had an opportunity to return to the land of Ur of the Chaldees, what did he choose? He chose to look ahead. He says, this is what God has said. Yes, this I have my relatives there. I was comfortable there. Most likely he had a home there. But this place where he's living, he's still living in tents. Without even a home. Without even a house. Hello? But because God had spoken, he dwelt on the land, that word of God. He meditated on the word. He meditated on the word. When the Lord told him to go and sacrifice Isaac, he went with his son Isaac. And the Bible says, oh, he did not waver. He never wavered. Why? He considered that, you know what? God has the power even to raise him from the dead. So the Bible says, he never even imagined, he never dwelt on Isaac being dead. Did you hear that? His heart did not stay on him being dead, but it stayed on him being alive. And the Bible says that figuratively, it's like he was raised from the dead. Hallelujah. He stayed on the word. He stayed on what God has said. Even when he didn't have a child for 26 years, he still stayed on the word. That God said, I will have children as many as the stars. And the Lord told me to look up. And you look up, I guess, maybe at night and say, I can't count the stars. This is how many my children will be. Hallelujah. And like the sand in the sea. Since you cannot count the sands, that is how many children I'll have. And today, if Abraham came back from heaven, he'll find the whole nation of Israel full. And they are all over in the world. That is his seed. Of one person, just the way the Lord said. Hallelujah. He chose to stay on that one. The Bible says that he had an opportunity. He would have remembered the Chaldees, his father, maybe his uncles, his home in the land of Ur of the Chaldees. That's where his home was. But he chose. He had an opportunity, but he did not. You have an opportunity to go back to the world. Do you refuse that in the name of Jesus? Bwana Yesu asifiwe. You have an opportunity, but you decline. You can look at the news and such. You have an opportunity to sin, but you will decline to sin. It is not your norm. It is not the norm according to the word of God. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Choose to look ahead. This is what the word of God says. I will hold on, I will stay on, my heart will stay on in the name of Jesus. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Amen. So we need to discipline our thoughts. Discipline our thoughts. Discipline your thoughts. What you allow to go through your thoughts, discipline it. Do not just allow anything to go through your thoughts. Anytime your thoughts wants to go away, capture them. Hallelujah. 2 Corinthians 10, isn't it? I take every thought captive and make it obey Christ. Let your thoughts obey Christ. Let my thoughts obey Christ. Continuously in the name of Jesus. The word of God is the best way. Meditating on it. Any other thought that wants, the enemy wants you to entertain. Maybe somebody's coming to tell you, you know, to talk about somebody. Now you know so and so. Now you know. Eh? Now this church, I don't even know what is happening. Tell them the Lord will help us.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. Don't entertain. Eh? Kama tu watu wanakufa. Tell them the Lord will see us.
Amen.
I choose to lean on him. I choose to meditate on the word of God. He said, you'll prosper as he will. He said, you'll bring revival, he will bring. I can't wait to see it coming to pass soon in the name of Jesus. Hang on to the word of God.
Amen.
Do you know so-and-so? Do you know some people? Tell them, hey, yeah, I don't know about that. You know? I know the Lord has more power than any other power.
Yes.
I choose to stay on the word. I refuse fear to dominate my life. Fear will not dominate my life. I choose to meditate on the word of God. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. So discipline your thoughts. Don't entertain these things. People will come even in church. Even after that, even after a service like this, somebody can come out there and start calling yourself, Uja, where would you come and tell them? You don't know. I know you don't know. Unless they are telling you the word of God, tell them, I'm not interested in knowing that. That, can you share the word of God? Can you share a scripture? Can you give me, you know, maybe a scripture that you have been meditating on this week, how it has taught you? That is what will build each other. That is what will build us. The other one will destroy us and finish us. Bwana asifiwe, murmuring, gossiping, complaining, wrong attitude will destroy the church. Let's learn to meditate on the word, to discipline our thoughts. Memorizing the scripture. This is only meditating on the word of God. Learn to memorize the scripture. Memorize the scripture. Spend time thinking about the word of God. Spend time thinking how God will move in the church. I wish you could all come with that attitude. God, are you not going to move today? Are you not going to do a new thing in our midst today? Lord God Almighty, I can't wait to see the move of God. I can't wait to see the power of God. I can't wait to see the presence of God and the Spirit of God. And people getting delivered from sicknesses and diseases. People getting delivered from demons and devils. People getting delivered from poverty and need and want. Know what I can't wait to see? And you meditate upon that. And you pray about it. And you get hold of another sister. You get hold of another brother. And you pray concerning the same. What does he feel? Number three, yielding to the Spirit of God. Yielding to the Spirit of God. Yielding to the Spirit of God. We need to learn to yield. Yielding to the Spirit of God. We just yield. Yielding ni kujiwachilia tu. Kwa Roho Mtakatifu au wewe kwa Mungu. That Holy Spirit I am here. I surrender. Really, just surrendering. Just surrendering to you. Lord, I surrender. I totally surrender. I completely surrender. I give myself to you. My body, my soul, my spirit, my conscious, my subconscious mind. My thoughts, Lord. My thought life. I surrender into you. My finances, I surrender to you. My thoughts. The ideas, I surrender to my tongue and my lips. You know, the psalmist said in Psalms 25, put a guard over my mouth. Put a guard. Wenda kufuli kwa mdomo wangu. That I may not speak what I ought not to speak. But I surrender to you. I let loose. I let go. My heart, I let it to you, Lord. My thoughts. My conscious, my subconscious mind. My spirit, I surrender to you. What I hear, I surrender to you. What I surrender to you, my eyes, my spiritual eyes, my ears, my spiritual ears. I surrender to you, my heart. I surrender to you the eyes of my heart, because the heart has eyes. So I surrender that they may be illuminated only by your spirit. I surrender, I refuse them to be dulled by the spirit of the enemy. But let them be illuminated by your spirit. So I surrender. Hallelujah. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Oh, shouldn't you learn just to surrender before the Lord, just to yield before the Spirit of God? Then our hearts automatically will be yielded to God, will be yielded to the Spirit of God. When we are then yielded to the Spirit of God, what can the Lord do in our midst, brethren? Oh, hallelujah. What miracle can he not perform in our midst? I am saying even the thinking that the dead will come back to life. Once we let loose and say, Lord God, I refuse to be hardened towards you. Instead, I'll be hardened towards the things of the world. And we to be removed, you put, I am hardened towards them. I don't want them. All what I want is you, Lord. All I want is you. All I want is you. I surrender to you. I surrender to you. I commit myself to you. I yield myself to my spirit to you, Lord. Amen. My ability to think, Lord, I surrender it to you. I desire to be guided. I desire to be led. I desire the wisdom that comes from the Spirit of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
In Psalms 51, verse 17, the Bible says, Psalms 51, 17. Let's read together. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. Oh God, you will not despise. God does not despise a heart that is broken. And he desires our hearts to be broken. Amen. Our hearts to be broken, to be contrite before you, to be surrendered before you. Just to be broken. That there's nothing I hold on to myself. I let go. I let you, Lord. I let loose. I am here. I am all yours. God, I'm here. I am all yours, Lord. Take control. Take preeminence. Take charge of my tongue, of my lips, of my thoughts, of my eyes. Hallelujah. Of my ears, of my spiritual ears. Amen. Surrender even your ability. Everything within you. Surrender it to the Lord. Amen. Also, when you tell him, Lord, search me and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious to see if there's anything in remove it from my heart. Search my heart. Out of the heart comes issues of life. isn't it? In our hearts is where issues, deep issues come from. When you see somebody sinning, they have been meditating upon the sin. Don't tell them, let them not cheat you and it happened, it just happened. Things do not just happen, they are going to happen. So if you go sinning, you'll just allow it. When you surrender to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, then the Lord will take over. Then sin will not be your friend. Yieldedness becomes the norm. Being broken before the Lord becomes the norm. Amen. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. Hallelujah. So we have talked about the three things, isn't it? We have talked about the word of God, isn't it? Hearing what? What you hear. We guard what you hear. And you should mostly hear what? The word of God. Then number two, meditating on the word. And number three, yielding to the Spirit of God. I pray that these three things will work on them this week. This is our week of prayer and fasting starting tomorrow. That as you are fasting, please look through these scriptures. Think of this. Amen. It includes disciplining of our flesh, of our bodies. Most of our bodies are not disciplined. You give them food from January to January. You know, sinakula, sinakula, sinakula. Anytime you want to fast, to fika sande, nafanya nini? The knees start fellowshipping. Seriously. Until you say, yeah, God, you can see I've tried. No, it's 10 o'clock now. From yesterday when I ate at 8, now it is 10 today in the morning. Allow me just to take tea. That's it. Look, if you can't discipline your body, you can't also discipline it even to lift its hands. You can't tell the body, let's lift our hands up. That's why most of us, our hands, let's lift our hands. It goes half mast and goes down. The body tells you, oh, I'm too tired. You tell the body, you know what? This is what we are going to do for them. The body tells you, no, let's relax. We must learn to discipline ourselves. Pray that in this week, we take time to pray, we take time to fast, and we'll work especially on our yielding ourselves to the Lord, meditating upon the word of God, disciplining this flesh. Let's stand. Just go before the Lord and in a few minutes, open your mouth, open your heart, and tell